The question is often asked as if there was no problem, but is everything rosy in the science garden? It is easy to put science on a pedestal, and many do, believing it to be free from petty politics and bias. As we will see, however, this is far from the case. Science is a human endeavour and, much like any other, the truth is that greed and egotism can play their part. In fact, it is often joked that science proceeds funeral by funeral. Moreover, cosmology, the study of the nature of the universe, is known as the queen of the sciences because it provides a building blocks for most other scientific disciplines. This only adds to the inertia against change. We've all heard the platitudes. Science is a self-correcting mechanism. It follows the evidence wherever it may lead. Here's another one. Quote, science is humble. It knows what it knows and it knows what it doesn't know. It bases its conclusions and beliefs on hard evidence. It doesn't get offended when new facts come along. It embraces the body of knowledge. It doesn't hold on to medieval practices because they are tradition. Close quote. This quote from the British comedian Ricky Gervais also expresses the ideal. Given it suggests that there are only two real choices, science and superstition, it is equally naive, amusing even, although I'm guessing that's not what he had intended on this occasion. It's a false dichotomy, essentially. The point is that legitimate concerns can be raised about popular science, and to do so is not to advocate for the return of witchcraft. It's not a binary choice. A more pertinent question arises. Has a lot of pop science itself become quasi-religious or cult-like? It's certainly not unusual to hear terms like scientism bandied around. Rupert Sheldrake, among others, uses the term. A noted critic of dogmatic science and a man with an impressive CV, Sheldrake wrote The Science Delusion, Freeing the Spirit of Inquiry. It was published as Science Set Free in the US. Furthermore, how can science know what it doesn't know? Isn't that a logical fallacy unless we assume, by implication, that we know almost all there is to know, save for a few loose ends? This seems hubristic, not humble. Surely, the most exciting thing about science is that we have so much more to learn. Humility should be key. The Big Bang. Ironically, today's dominant cosmology, the Big Bang, has theological origins. In 1927, the Belgian priest and mathematician Georges Lemaître proposed the idea to reconcile science with St. Thomas Aquinas' theological dictum of creation out of nothing. As it happens, a lot of Big Bangers also display something akin to a religious devotion for their cherished theory. More relevant, of course, is the evidence, or lack of it, to support an expanding universe. The Big Problem. According to the Big Bang, there was nothing in the beginning, which exploded. This is a big problem because it violates one of the best-tested laws of physics, the conservation of energy and matter, since the Big Bang produces energy at a titanic rate out of nothingness, and to ignore this basic law would never be acceptable in any other field of physics. Big Bangers dance around this issue by claiming that the initial explosion or rapid expansion, call it what you will, created the laws of physics that we now observe. It's a classic case of circular reasoning, no less. Quote, the extraordinary thing is that scientists accept the Big Bang and in the same breath deride the creationists. Close quote, Wolf Thornhill. Seeing red. So many galaxies and quasars appear to be related and interacting. The problem is that their redshift suggests they are millions of light years apart, as required by an expanding universe, despite simple visual analysis indicating they are much closer. Holton Arp, an outstanding student of Edwin Hubble, discovered numerous redshift anomalies that undermine the Big Bang's recessional interpretation, the notion that the universe is expanding. Arp detailed many of them in his book, The Atlas of Peculiar Galaxies. This upset a lot of Big Bangers, most of whom choose to close their eyes to the blasphemy. Arp was dubbed a modern-day Galileo after his telescope time was withdrawn and he was forced to move from the US to the Max Planck Institute in Germany. The title of his last book, Seeing Red, is a clever wordplay. A continuation of his redshift research, it also hints at his anger after being cast out by the scientific establishment. Quote, of course, if one ignores contradictory observations, one can claim to have an elegant or robust theory, but it isn't science. close quote, Holt and Arp. The CMB. The cosmic microwave background is off-cited as conclusive proof of the Big Bang. The sleight of hand was to interpret it as a remnant heat signature. However, the background temperature of space was predicted by many beforehand and with more accuracy before expansion models were taken seriously. Many prefer to ignore this fact. The CMB has effectively been commandeered by the Big Bang bandwagon, although there are better options, and that's another big problem for them. Quote, the CMB is a radio fog of dense plasma filaments, close quote. Eric Lerner, LPP Fusion. Lerner's interpretation is consistent with the filamentary plasma universe, now observed more clearly than ever by the new James Webb Space Telescope. If Lerner and other plasma physicists are correct, the CMB tells us nothing about the age of the universe. The JWST has revealed many more anomalies that challenge assumptions arising from the Big Bang. One astronomer even cried panic. An open letter to closed minds. In May 2004, several leading scientists, plasma physicists, and independent researchers signed a petition attached to an open letter to the scientific community. It was published in The New Scientist and dubbed an open letter to closed minds in some quarters. The letter focused on several problems, including the Big Bang's increasing reliance on hypothetical entities, a reluctance to consider alternative views, and the effective bias of the peer review system, dominated as it is by Big Bangers. Sadly, little has changed in the last 20 years. Another scandal erupted in 2022 involving the censorship of papers that challenged the Big Bang model. Peer pressure vis-a-vis peer review. Peer review is often cited as an infallible mechanism for ensuring scientific integrity, but this notion is problematic. According to Britannica.com, quote, the primary function of peer review is gatekeeping, close quote. The senior academics and scientists who review scientific papers are invariably pillars in prevailing paradigms and seemingly reluctant to give credit to alternative ideas. Competition for funding is no doubt a factor. They also enjoy anonymity so they can effectively stifle careers with impunity. Quote, the peer review system often creates near insurmountable hurdles against the publication of data that seems contrary to long-held beliefs. Close quote. Dr. Friedman T. Freund. Just 1 week after the publication of the open letter, an enraged professor succeeded in supporting the concerns raised while simultaneously disagreeing with them. In a piece entitled Doubt and Dissent Are Not Tolerated, the last paragraph of his rebuttal reads like the rant of a spoiled child. Quote, so, if I get to decide whether to allocate money or jobs to one of the bright graduate students working on some of the many fruitful issues raised by Big Bang cosmology, or divert it to a crackpot who claims that the Big Bang has no empirical successes, it's an easy choice. Not censorship, just sensible allocation of resources in a finite world. Close quote. Sean Carroll, Professor of Natural Philosophy, Johns Hopkins University. Does Professor Carroll seriously believe his favoured theory is beyond question, an attitude that runs contrary to the basic principles of science? He even suggests that only a crackpot would question the Big Bang. Clearly, he is putting ideology before evidence. Talking people down. Early in the last century, the prestigious magazine Scientific American ran an article ridiculing the alleged flights of Wilbur and Orville Wright, some years after they had been flying successfully. Not knowing what they didn't know, as it turns out, contrary to Gervais's claim, heavier-than-air flight was deemed impossible by scientists and the US military. Bizarrely, a lack of media coverage was considered strong evidence against their claims. The media, meanwhile, didn't take the claims seriously because the leading experts of the day told them not to bother. The situation was prophetic. Today, artful debunkers frequently dismiss alternative views out of hand and all too often resort to ad hominem arguments. Quote, science is the belief in the ignorance of the experts, close quote, Richard Feynman. Eternal vigilance. The price of liberty, as they say, is eternal vigilance. While this expression is oft used in a political context, it also has implications for science. Despite what we hear from the usual talking heads paraded in the media today, with their predictable appeals to authority, and from censorial platforms like Wikipedia with its army of militant editors, a lot of settled science remains contentious. Quote, the public has a distorted view of science because children are taught in school that science is a collection of firmly established truths. In fact, science is not a collection of truths. It is a continuing exploration of mysteries. Close quote. Freeman Dyson. The last 100 years illustrate the failure of those involved in the scientific process to follow its ideals. Moreover, the much talked about crisis in cosmology looks set to continue given that the mechanisms originally put in place to ensure impartiality have become self-serving. Again, this is a big problem given that science is supposed to be a self-correcting mechanism. As ever, Hannes Alfvén, the father of plasma physics and plasma cosmology, summed up the situation eloquently. Quote, the peer review system is satisfactory during quiescent times, but not during a revolution in a discipline such as astrophysics, when the establishment seeks to preserve the status quo. Close quote. Hannes Alfvén. In the next episode of this series, we will take a look at another common question in Misconception number 2. Where's the science?